gentlemen, welcome to the Good and Plenty and the Good and Plenty Diner. The Mother's Club players would like to welcome you to the Nifty Fifties.
I hope everyone has had a chance to read the Hillsdale High Happenings. It will give you some background on a few of the kids who will be joining us here at the diner. On the flip side of the newspaper, you'll find a place to take notes as the clues are revealed throughout the show. Following scene three, you'll have a chance to tell us who you think the culprit is.
All right, now sit back, enjoy some popcorn and the show.
I just don't understand it, Peggy Sue. Why would anyone steal your scarf from my car?
I don't know, John. Hi, Maybelle.
Hi, Peggy Sue.
We searched everywhere, twice. I looked behind the car, you looked behind the seats. Where could your scarf be? Are you sure you looked for it?
Yes, John, I searched behind the seats. I'll give you another scarf for your mirror. Don't worry, I'm sure somebody's just pulling a prank on you.
Probably that no good greaser, Mac Heath. He's a criminal, you know. I've seen him following you around. If he so much as breathed on my car.
I'm sure someone's just playing a joke.
Well, but we kept searching. Are you sure you searched?
Yes, I am. Oh, look. Oh, look. We're engaged to be engaged. I'll just give you another scarf for the mirror. Look, it's even made it into the Hillsdale High Happenings. It says, while it's official, after 6 months of going steady, John E. the B. Good, Jr. and Peggy Sue, daughter of Sam Sue of Sue's Survival Supplies, are engaged.
Engaged to be engaged, Peggy.
When asked when the big day will be, John E. Good, Jr. said, I have to think about my future. Someday I'll be taking over my father's work in this town, and I need to be ready. Peggy Sue, reporter for the Hillsdale Happenings, had nothing further to add.
What's there to add?
What about our future, John?
You know I have to go to college first, Peggy Sue.
It's just that you sound so cold.
Except for the engaged to be engaged part, I'd say Tina Tattle had it all right. You know I need to go to college first. My old man expects a lot out of me. We have a reputation to maintain in this town. Oh, Peggy, you know I love you, Peggy Sue.
Peggy Sue, then you know why I feel blue without Peggy.
So it's your birthday today, isn't it? Miss Molly said so yesterday in class. You're so lucky she baked it. Cake?
She bakes a cake every Friday.
But this time she lit the candles. What can I get you?
Two.
Two strawberry milkshakes.
I think I'll have chocolate.
What? Chocolate? But you always have strawberry, just like I do.
Maybe she wants chocolate. After all, it is her birthday.
Well, all right. Chocolate. That email. She's so kooky. Always talking about her duck and cover drills. I swear.
But she's smart. She's got the jets. She helps me with my physics homework. And besides, it's hard to be liked sometimes.
Well, I'd say it's hard to fit in, especially if she keeps on running duck and cover drills, it goes about handing out how to survive the fallout pamphlets. She's been following me around a lot lately. It's just plain kooky. She's such an oddball, she could probably make a hydrogen bomb.
Now, John, we all can't play the guitar.
Yeah, I'm pretty good, aren't I?
John, you know I love your music, but all these girls screaming.
Oh, they're a little distracting, but think of how Elvis must feel with all them screaming.
What about his wife?
Oh, those girls don't mean anything to me, Peggy. Really, they don't. But I would give anything to see Elvis play, but my dad won't let me go.
Hi, what can I get you two?
You're not together.
I'll have a burger, chips, and a Coca-Cola.
A cherry Coke.
Yeah.
Burger, chips, Coke, and a cherry Coke. Here's something to read while you're waiting, Mac. We cannot underestimate the intelligence of the enemy. They sent a dog into space. Can you believe it? No re-entry plan. It died, lost in space. Next, they'll be heading to the moon. We can't have a red moon. This is very important. Most importantly, it's not the Russians we have to fear, but ourselves. We're building nuclear power plants on our very doorstep. Power plants capable of storing the same force from which the sun draws its power. It's vital you learn how to protect yourself in case of fallout, in case of a thermonuclear explosion. Read this, Mac.
Do you mean you'd rather be sitting over there with them?
They're all right.
Oh, I'm telling you, she's a commie. Her dad was Cuban, her mother too. She's our maid. She can hardly even speak English.
So this country's made up of immigrants.
Yeah, 100 years ago. My family founded this country. My family came over on the Mayflower. And now it's nothing but greaser Irishmen and commie Cubans. Chocolate. Like the third tone on my Chevy El Camino. My sure beats the old tank, the tank my old man was driving. My new Bent 8 with the ragtop.
Yeah, I understood. Your new Chevy El Camino, your new V8, and your convertible.
Don't rattle your cage, paper shaker.
What do you mean, paper shaker? You know very well I am no longer on the cheerleading squad. I had to quit last year to work for my dad. I had to choose between cheerleading and the school newspaper. Not all of us are as lucky as you, Johnny Good. Some of us, not everyone has everything like you do, like goods up on the hill, Hillsdale.
Oh, Peggy Sue,
what?
I met my dad's Chevy El Camino, his new V8.
You did?
Of course I did. I know I'm just borrowing it. I mean, he lent it to me and all. I just forgot for a moment. She's a real cherry, huh? I'll just go ensure and make sure that no one's, you know, breathed on her.
And it's short early morning.
Peggy!
Yes, John?
My dad's car! It's this Chevy El Camino! It's gone!
What? How?
I don't know! We drove out there and now it's gone!
Wait a minute, take a breath. Let's think about this.
It's my dad! He's going to kill me! It's gone, I tell you!
Good afternoon, Peggy.
Oh, good golly, Miss Molly. Did you see who drove away in my car?
Why, no. Is something wrong, John?
Good afternoon, Miss Molly. Apparently there is. Someone stole John's car.
It's not my car, it's my father's.
Well, I didn't see anything.
It was pink with white and chocolate trim in back. You know, John took me for a ride today. Are you sure it's stolen, John?
Of course I'm sure. It was right out front with the top down.
What's taking so long with my order?
Hi, Miss Molly.
Hi, Maybelle. How are you?
Today's Peggy's birthday.
Yes, yes, I know. Maybelle, you just seem a bit excited.
Have you had your duck and cover drill
yet? Not yet, but it should be soon.
Good, good, good.
Well, since you haven't had it, I'll just be going. But I did stop by to give you this.
Oh, thanks, Miss Molly. I promise I'll try harder next time. Thanks for letting me retake the exam.
Maybelle, perhaps you just should stop doing that shop class. I don't understand. You should be taking home ec. And working on etiquette, dear, your posture. Look at your posture. And you're not always going to work in a diner. You need to learn to set the table properly. You'll have a home of your own someday, dear. Oh. Well, I'll be home.
But Miss Molly, you can't go. You've got to help me get my car back.
John, there is no use in shouting.
Hey, where's my burger?
It's coming, it's coming.
As you consider what you've learned so far, the Pink Ladies will serve you the specialty of the good and plenty, the Pink Ladies basket, and Coca-Cola.
And then we'll be entertained by the Mitchell family dancers, dancing to "You're the One I Want."
She's ready.
The big
river, right?
Thank you.
In a vintage Coca-Cola ashtray? We have to wait on our dancer to get back in costume.
There she goes.
Get up!
What's up with you?
Everyone knows you stole my car.
What are you carrying on about?
Everyone knows you're a criminal. Everyone knows about the police car you stole. Peggy wrote all about it in the Hillsdale Happenings. See? Matt, sometimes known as the Knife, due to his regrettably rougher early years, is, like many of us, deeply misunderstood. Oh my, poor Mac, the Knife.
Leave me alone. Just let me sit here and eat my burger.
Right, oh, duck butt. You need some more fries? Do you need some more grease for your hair?
Look, I paid for what I did.
Yeah, right. He admits his guilt, has performed his works of public service as a juvenile offender, and is most genuinely sorry for his actions in the past. Public service, so you helped a couple old ladies across a busy street or something. You still stole a police car. You're still a criminal. Everyone knows it. I want my car back, you hood.
I did not steal your car. I don't need some top-of-the-hill rich kid accusing me of something I did not do.
Get up.
No.
What? Are you chicken? Like your old man? You know, my old man said that he sang, turned commie, squealed like a pig to the North Koreans.
You leave my father out of this.
Son of a commie, come on, nosebleed.
Now, John, that's just going too far.
My father was a POW, a prisoner of war. He was held prisoner for 2 years, and not once did he talk. He's a braver American than you or your father will ever be. And don't you dare insult him again, or I'll knock you out. Do you hear me?
Easy now. They don't serve knuckle sandwiches here, Greaser. You see, Peggy, some temper. I told you, I think you're a bit too soft on him. I've seen you write better, like your last article for the Happenings. I think you're losing your edge. You know, I haven't seen him driving that old jacked up Ford-O-Matic he used to have. What? You totaled it? Tina Tattle says you need a new car, and I agree with her completely. Thank goodness we won't have to see that eyesore parked in the school lot again.
It's a rumor, John. Just a rumor.
Yeah, but we're engaged. She got that right.
Engaged to be engaged.
I haven't seen that old beater around lately, have you? I think Tina Tattle's got something here. What do you call it? Journalistic integrity? I think Mac here needed a car, and he's stolen mine.
Your old man's car?
That's crazy. You saw me come in here and order. If I stole your car, would I be sitting here eating a burger?
How do I know you didn't just hotwire it and drive it around back?
That's just stupid. If it's around back, go out and look for yourself.
Hadn't we better call the police?
Yeah, of course. Somebody get him on the horn.
I'll call him.
I've got the keys.
You're so sure I stole your daddy's precious car. Who do you think you are? Perry Mason?
Perhaps you wouldn't have had to hotwire the car. Maybe you had the key.
What are you talking about?
I've got the keys.
Maybe he made a copy.
Oh, how would he have a copy, Mona? Sometimes you're on another planet, just like, and you should join Maybell's Kooky Club.
I can't. It's been canceled.
No thanks to you, John.
What?
You asked Headmaster Saunders if you could schedule your car club meetings on Thursday afternoons.
Yeah, and he said yes, so what?
That's the only afternoon Maybell has off from here. She can't reschedule.
Reschedule what?
Her freedom from the Fallout Club. You know she's been talking about it for weeks.
She asked you 3 times to change the day of your club's meeting. Haven't you read what she's been writing about? She's been following us around a lot.
So what about her stupid club? The car club is much more popular. Everyone knows that. Why do you think Headmaster Saunders gave me the go-ahead?
He gave you permission because Headmaster Saunders is your father's best friend.
This doesn't answer my question, Mona. How can Mac the Knife Heath have a key to my car?
It's simple. He made a copy.
What?
My mom works as a maid in your house, right? So one day when she was picking up your father's laundry at Lenny's laundromat, she found keys in the jacket of your dad's pocket, your pocket jacket.
Yeah, I found them after you dropped off the laundry. And I'm the one who showed them to your mom when she picked everything up. Just ask her. I can't lose this job. I didn't copy anyone's keys.
Mac, John didn't just drop off the laundry, did he?
What do you mean? Of course I dropped off the laundry. I knew I should have checked all the pockets.
John, my dad's business is right across the street from Lenny's. From where I sit answering the phones, I can see everything that goes on over there. I saw you walk in, talk with Mac, and then throw the clothes in his face. I wouldn't blame him for being mad and wanting to steal your car. You insult him every chance you get, and today you've insulted his dad.
I did not steal anything.
I know you didn't, Mac, but anyway.
I, for one, can't vouch for Mac. Character, Mr. Billings, the school counselor, has nothing but good things to say about Mac and how he's rehabilitated himself. I know you didn't steal John's car, Mac. I know it. You've become a fine, upstanding young citizen, Mac. Unlike some here, we know. Anyway, you know, real repentance and the power of finding forgiveness in the eyes of others. This is a lesson that some of us need to learn.
If you are referring to me, Miss Molly, just because I failed your class and I can't walk a straight line with a book on my head, doesn't mean I'm not a fine, upstanding citizen. Your class is a joke.
Well, yes, Mona, I can see that you would think that. I do not think anything of your inability to balance a book on your head and your lack of etiquette. Personally, I find it strange that you don't know how to cross your ankles when you sit, but that's neither here nor there. What matters is that I think you'll soon learn that walking to the beat of your own drum in this town will get you nowhere. I tried walking to the beat of a different drummer, and look where it got me.
She means she lost her job because she wasn't doing it properly.
Only in the eyes of some, like your father.
And Headmaster Saunders.
Well, of course, he and your father are best friends, and they're the best judges of everything in this town. Isn't that so, John?
You lost your history and geography job because you were filling our heads with nonsense. Garbage about China and Russia and Korea and how they really aren't all that bad.
And you know, you mean North Korea, John. If history were as simple as you
make it sound. It's just obvious that you never listen to anything.
I don't see how this is getting us any closer to finding my car. Did she call the police? Ma'am, did you call the police?
Oh. If anyone has a reason to steal John's car, it's Mona. Her father left her and her mother with practically nothing. I hear they're hurting for money.
Oh, fine. Blame the poor immigrant family now. This is ridiculous. How was I supposed to steal his car when I can't even drive?
Everyone knows your mother used to be a lawyer in Cuba and now is working as a maid in my house. How humiliating that must be for her.
Don't you dare talk about my mother, John. What about your mother?
Okay then, your father? Why did he leave Cuba, huh? He must have been a commie. Everyone knows he was called up before the House Un-American Committee. He was questioned by McCarthy himself.
Who was censured 3 months later?
I told you the last time you talked about my father and called him a commie that I
cut his lights out. I think that's what you said. As a matter of fact, I wrote it in my little book here. That's what you said, and then I failed you for the rules of dating. You know, threatening your date is no way to earn points in my etiquette class.
But he...
Oh, John, Mona, she has terrible posture. Look at it. But she's no commie. Neither is her father, nor is her mother. If you had listened more attentively in my history class, you would know that.
Mona Lisa, Mona Lisa, men have named you. You're so like a lady with...
Oh, my parents fled from Cuba. They fled 7 years ago, 1951. I was 8. My father was a doctor, a successful doctor in Havana. We were doing pretty well, but there was lots of poverty. No security and no real democracy. My dad wanted better for his family. So 7 years ago, we moved to the USA, right at the height of McCarthy's witch hunt. America was fighting communists in Korea. Yes, he was brought before the committee, but he was no communist. Two of his patients turned out to be convicted. He didn't know they were communists. It's not like it shows. It killed him. He died not long after that. Oh, the shame. I learned English quickly. But my mother, who had been an attorney in Cuba, could only find work as a maid for John E. Good. It's a good job, but I am tired of hearing about how easy life is for that family on the hill. And someday, just someday, we'll be living the life like we once did in Cuba.
I've heard enough of this sob story. You know, someone stole my old man's car, and when I find out who it was, wait, I can't find my keys. Someone stolen the keys.
Duck and cover, duck and cover. Everyone, assume the duck and cover position now. Everyone, we need to take this threat seriously. Assume the duck and cover position now. Everyone, head down. Good job, ma'am. Good job. Good job, sir. Keep your head down. You have to be prepared in case of a nuclear explosion. Keep your head down. All right. All clear. I repeat, all clear. Thank you.
You did good.
Well, my goodness, now that that's over with, well, we need to get back to working out what happened to Mr. Good's car.
I did not steal his car.
No one is saying you did, Mac. I'm just trying to get everything clear before the police arrive. Now, John, you're quite sure you've lost your keys? Because if you lost them, or even if you left them in the ignition, somebody could have stolen your car. Now think carefully, when did you last have your keys?
I picked up Peggy from her dad's office, Sue's survival supplies. I filled up the car at the station, and then we drove here for a milkshake to celebrate. I parked the car, and we came in, and then the car was gone.
Okay, and that's everything exactly as it happened?
Well, no, we don't know exactly when, but we found that my scarf was missing.
Your scarf?
My mirror warmer.
Your mirror?
Peggy's scarf. She hung it on the mirror so everyone would know we were engaged.
Engaged to be engaged?
Yeah.
Oh, I see. So your scarf is missing, but it could have just blown away as you were driving down the road. You did have the top down, right?
It was tied really tight. Someone stole it, I'm telling you.
Well, I really think it's more important that we work out what's happened with your keys. Now, you are sure you had your keys the entire time?
Yeah, I'm sure of it.
Okay, well, since now you've you're sure you lost your keys?
Yes, I'm sure of it.
Maybe you should check again.
Search
for them. Look one more time.
Okay. Oh, my old man's going to. But they're here.
Ah, well, now that you found your keys, we can assume that someone has hot wire in the car. I think it highly improbable that anyone, copied your key. Now, before the police arrive, we'll need to eliminate all of us as possible suspects. We need to think about the only people here capable of hot wiring a car would be Mac.
I'm telling you, I did not steal the car.
Can you or can't you hot wire a car?
Of course I can hot wire a car. It's dead easy. But I didn't. What reason would I have for stealing your car? For one thing, everyone in town would know it's yours. Who else drives a 1958 three-toned Chevy Aldomino?
Once you and your hot rod buddies have your hands on it, I bet you can jack it up, repaint it. Easy. Isn't that what you guys do? I mean, when you steal cars.
Okay, now, as I was saying, the only people here capable of hot wiring a car would be Mac and
Maybell.
Maybell?
Yes. Yes, Maybell. It has come to my attention that Miss Lean has signed up for shop class when she really should be taking home economics. I don't know if they teach hot wiring in shop, but it certainly doesn't look good to have a young lady taking a class meant for boys. Not only does it go against any sense of propriety that I'm endeavoring to instill into my girls, it's just plain dull. I mean, after all, who would want to spend all day in a basement with a group of boys?
Well,
and they're loudmouthed to boot.
Hi, y'all.
Oh, my.
Hey, Maybell.
Hi, Marilyn. You all know Marilyn Moodrow.
Good afternoon, Marilyn.
I just thought I'd drop off these physics notes that we talked about during class. If you want, you can give those back to me in shop class. Tiger, Mr. Steen, is going to talk about how to explain the uses of a soldering iron. I am so excited. I can hardly wait.
Well, thanks, Mary Lynn.
Golly, you look nice.
Well, thank you. This little thing, I just threw this on.
It's Hazy's birthday.
Is it really? Oh, yes, Miss Molly said so in class. Well, I must sing to you before I go.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Mr. President. Happy birthday to you.
By the way, I like shop class. It's really useful.
Yeah, Maybelle could have learned how to hotwire a car. She could have hotwired the car. No problem.
John, does Mr. Steen teach hotwiring in shop?
Of course not. Mac is just trying to shift the blame. I know you're guilty.
There's a book on it in the library. Maybe she checked it out. She's smart, you know.
Well, if you know there's a book in the library, maybe you checked it out.
Oh, Mona's failing physics.
Miss Molly?
Well, I'm just trying to defend you, dear. It's true, you know. Mr. Steen, your shop teacher, told me that he found you and Mary Lynn Moodrow working really late in the shop class last week, and you didn't have permission to be there. What were you doing, Maybelle?
We were just working on a physics experiment.
Physics in the basement. Why not just ask permission to use the lab during school hours?
I have already cleared everything with Mr. Steen. We had some theories that needed tested, that was all. I wouldn't expect any of you to understand. The new shop skills I'm learning are too important to be wasted on stealing John Good's car. Of course, none of you will know the important work I'm doing because I can't get my feet from the fallout from going!
Speaking of the bomb, it seems things aren't going so well for Sue's survival supplies, are they?
I don't see what my dad's business is any of your business, or what it has to do with John's missing car.
It's just that you also have a reason for wanting Maybelle's nuclear awareness club to take place. The more people who hear Maybelle's message, the more customers for your father, the more people to stock their bomb shelters with food and supplies to last through the fall.
What does this have to do with John's missing car?
I don't know exactly, but perhaps you want to teach him a lesson.
What do you
mean? Goodness knows he deserves one.
What do you mean by that?
My mom told me she overheard both of your fathers talking the other day.
Was she listening in on my father's phone calls?
It seems Sue's survival supply is in trouble, and it seems Mr. Good is planning to buy them out. And you know that every company Mr. Good touches, he ruins it.
My father is a successful businessman.
Your father was a war profiteer.
How dare you?
It's true. He sold scrap metal on the black market instead of donating it to the war effort. Everyone knows about it.
And how is it that your father and Headmaster Saunders both stayed here instead of going to the Pacific? Funny how that happened with both of them and their friends, isn't it?
You know what, John? Perhaps you're just a chip off the old clock. I bet you staged this whole thing.
I bet you got someone to steal your own car, and your father's going to cash it in for the insurance.
That's ridiculous.
It's not so ridiculous, John. I read all about your father down at the county courthouse when I was researching the editorial that I wrote about Mac. I planned on keeping this a secret, but I have it here. During the war, your old man was accused of burning down his own factory for the insurance money. Mm-hmm. Some workers were caught in the flames and died. John, people died.
My father's not a criminal. He was accused, not convicted.
Maybe not, John, but you do have a lot to learn.
And a pity your father didn't give me the chance to teach you.
Well, I don't think my old man would like you teaching me anything, Miss Molly. Rumor has it, you're a communist.
I'm?
That's why you lost your job, Miss Molly. That's why your lessons were being recorded.
They were being recorded. I knew it.
That's why you spend so much time with the likes of Mona here. Everyone knows she's a red. Just look at her, how she's dressed.
I dress this way because I'm a beatnik, you imbecile.
So you're like that beatnik? What's his name? The one whose poem wasn't even allowed in the country?
Allen Ginsberg.
Yeah, him. Obscene, that's what they called it.
Howl is poetry. Jack Kerouac says so too.
How did you get your hands on such filth?
It's not filth, it's beatific. It's all about jazz, love, poetry, and individuality. It has nothing to do with communism or stealing cars.
So you all wear black turtlenecks. That's original. It's just plain weird, Mona. Perhaps you're the chip off the old block. I always knew there was something odd about your mother, and I just knew she was listening in on my dad's phone calls. She's probably a spy, like Ethel Rosenberg. And we all know what happened to her, don't we, Miss Molly?
My mother is a citizen of the United States of America. She's no spy. What about your mother, John? Whatever happened to her?
I spend time with Mona because she's, she's failing physics and she's failing my etiquette class too.
Great. Just tell everyone.
Good afternoon, everyone. My, this certainly must be the place to hang out after school. Hey.
Hi, Mr. Steen.
Hi, Mr. Steen.
Hi, Mr. Steen. Hi, Maybelle. I didn't know you worked here. We'll have a root beer. Funny girl, that Maybelle. Smart one, though. Too bad she's being led astray by that Mary Lynn Newsbro.
It's Mary Lynn?
Yeah, Maybelle's mother told me that Mary Lynn is nothing but trouble. She blamed her for them being in the basement after hours. Seems that Maybelle's been doing her homework. But then Mary Lynn's mother blames Maybelle and says the same thing about her. I guess we'll never know.
So, Maybelle didn't have permission to be in the basement, huh?
Of course not. It's dangerous enough for having teenagers around power tools during school, let alone having them after hours at night. I can't stay long.
But can I get you something, Miss Mabel, Molly?
So you teach etiquette, hey? But you used to teach history and geography.
Yes. Yeah. Do you want to know the real reason why I'm teaching etiquette now?
Why I spend my days with young girls instructing them on the rules of dating and proper posture instead of offering them the insights to the history of the world. Because Mr. John E. Good there spent time drawing little cars on the margins of his homework, and when I wrote home to his father a note telling him about his attitude, I was called into Headmaster Sawyer's office.
You rich kids have it so easy. John E.'s daddy comes to his rescue again. Poor John E. Hey, what does the E stand for? I know, easy. Taking the easy way out, paying your way out of the army. Hey, John, will your old man pay to get you out of the draft like his daddy did for him?
My father served in the National Guard. He might not have been a war hero, but he served his country.
Yeah, alongside Headmaster Saunders.
Must be nice having parents that can keep their kids out of combat, huh? My dad served until the very end. Ran supplies into West Berlin while your dad was taking it easy, smoking cigars. They say that's how the fire started. You know, the fire in your dad's factory, a lit cigar. So now you're taking lessons from him. Huh, Junior? How much insurance money did John E. Good Sr. get?
Why, you...
You both must get a hold of yourself. Maybelle, get them something to drink.
So, John, you haven't told me what you think about my idea. I say this whole thing has been staged. You stole your own car, or had Matt here steal it for you. And you just put this little display of bravado on to make us think that you're enemies. What do you say? Should I tell the Heat when they get here? I think they'd be interested to hear all about it.
Interested in what? Tell them what? That I stole my father's car for the insurance money? Ha! I should have only guessed that you would come up with such a kooky idea. Leave it to you or Maybelle. You're both about as crazy as they come. Anyway, it's my father's car. He'd be the one to get the money if I did what you said I did.
You always do what your father says.
And it's a good thing, too. At least he's not like your old man. I'm amazed that for such a smart girl, editor of the school paper, president of the French club, I'm amazed that you listen to him, that you work for him. I mean this for your own good, Peggy. When I tell you this, he's washed up. His business is a joke. Mona's right. My dad's had plans to buy out your dad's business for months now. My old man can make more money in one day than your dad can make in a whole month. He'll turn that business around in no time.
Maybe it's not all about money, John.
Sure it is. Only people who don't have money say that. You don't fool me, Peggy. I know why you're seeing me. I've known it for a long time. It makes you look good to wear my sweater.
I wear your sweater, John, because I thought...
I'm glad someone stole your scarf. I was thinking of getting rid of it anyway. It was the cheapest piece of material I think I've ever seen.
That's it. Now you're gonna get it. You're sad they don't serve knuckle sandwiches in here? Well, here, you can have that.
Well, well, you certainly had that one coming.
You broke my nose!
Here.
Why'd you have to go and do that? I think you better keep the pity for your new boyfriend, Peggy, because when I get my hands on him...
No one's getting their hands on anyone. Is that clear?
Yes, Miss Molly.
John? John, is that clear? You two are going to shake hands about it, and makeup. Is that clear?
Yes.
I didn't hear you.
Yes, Miss Molly.
While you're putting together all of the clues you've heard so far, the pink ladies will now serve ice cream and apple pie.
And the Mitchell family dancers will entertain you with Rock Around the Clock.
This table thinks that Dad came and took his car because he realized John had borrowed it without permission.
Okay, this table. Barbie, you're right. You got an idea?
Made him walk home.
Well, this one nobody else picked yet. Mabel. She was out. Not with them the most. She had the most opportunity.
Yeah, Maybell. This table thinks Maybell did it because she was away from the diner a lot.
She was delayed to call the police so she could
have
the car back.
Did she ever really call them?
Oh,
they haven't shown
did
up
she ever long. Really call the police?
They have yet to arrive.
Yeah, they've taken a long time to get
there. Okay.
This table. How about you guys? Do you have a theory?
We don't think it's stolen. We think he parked it in the wrong spot.
They think Johnny just forgot where he parked it.
Okay, what about this table?
We agreed Mabel.
Maybell.
She took forever to get their food out, so during that time she'd gone out.
Her tip went downhill.
She never called the police like they said. She used the duck and cover as the version to put the keys back in the in their, and she's mad at him for mad at him for not the car.
Oh yeah, that car.
Yeah. But it was the 50s. It was a much slower pace back then.
Well, all your answers are very interesting. But now, let's find out who really did it and why.
Dun, dun, dun.
You know what General Vance if you can't come around, then it's fine to tell the phone to help me crew.
Well, yeah, in my opinion, you're not doing it.
It's the scarf. It's the scarf. Where? What?
Oh. What?
It's the scarf.
Oh, it's the scarf.
The one you said had been stolen?
Yeah, but where did it come from?
My handbag.
From your what? Do you mean to tell me you've had it the whole time and just found it? I told you to search everywhere. Didn't you think to look in your own handbag?
I didn't need to.
Didn't need to?
Uh-oh.
I put it there.
But how?
Yes, John, in my handbag.
Oh, I don't understand. You've had the scarf this whole time?
Yes, in my handbag.
What are you doing?
Maybelle, when did you say the police are coming?
They're not coming, Miss Molly.
What? Not coming?
No, ma'am. I didn't call them.
What do you mean you didn't call them? You said you called them.
I didn't call them.
There was no need.
What do you mean there's no need? Someone stole my car and I want it back.
No one's stolen your car, John.
What? Next you're going to tell me you're engaged to Duckbutt here. Come on, Peggy. I was joking. You know you're the one who makes me look good.
I'm not engaged to Mac, and after today, I'm not engaged to be engaged.
But Peggy, I was just angry. I'm so upset about the car.
That's the problem, John. Last week, I finally realized what's wrong with our relationship. You will always love cars more than you will ever love me. I heard my mother and her friends talking about us at her Tupperware party. A Tupperware party, John. It seems everybody knows.
About what?
That you're just like Mona said, a chip off the old block. Ever wonder why your mother left your old man?
For crying out loud, Peggy. I told you never to repeat that to anyone.
I knew about it. My mom told me after she saw Miss Molly's comments on my report card. She told me instead of threatening to punch your lights out, I should have pity for you.
Pity? I don't need anyone's pity.
She said you'd act that way. You act the way you do because you need a mother. And that you're missing her. And that you are angry inside.
Oh, what do you know? Or your mother. Or anyone.
Everyone knows. And you know what else? They all know that your father loved his business and his money more than he loved your mother. That's why she left him. And that's why I stole your car.
You what?
All right.
I stole your car, and Magdalene helped me.
All right.
So she did hotwire the car. I knew she could do it.
Of course I could do it.
So you did check that book out at the
you
library.
Sure your car's locked in
no,
the
I didn't have to hotwire the car. I had the keys.
Out back?
No way.
Mary Lynn taught me.
Mary Lynn taught me.
Mary Lynn Lutheran?
Yes. That's what we were doing in the basement.
Oh.
We were working on wiring. Once we had the electric hedge trimmers going, we were going to move up to cars.
Oh dear.
Huh? But I didn't need to hot wire John's car. I had the keys, which I've already told you about. Huh?
You went out through the kitchen?
And then moved the car?
I went out through the kitchen and moved the car out back.
So, that's why you looked so excited when I walked in.
Out back!
It's there! My Chevy El Camino! All three lovely tones of it! It's there! No one's stolen it! But why?
I told you you had a lesson coming. I guess I was right.
Yes, Mona, you were right. The theft was staged, but not by John, by me.
But how? You had the keys, and you had the scarf?
Yes, I removed my scarf from the mirror while John was filling the car at the station. He didn't notice it was gone until we got here at the diner. And when he did notice, he put up such a fuss that someone had stolen it from his car, we had to just tear his car apart to find it. We still didn't. But he wasn't so worried about it having been stolen, though, seeing as it was so ugly.
I didn't mean.
You were upset that someone dared even breathe near your precious Chevy El Camino. Let alone reach in and steal something from it.
So, okay. Sorry, Mac, for thinking that you copied his keys.
It's okay.
Then John must have dropped them while searching for that scarf.
Exactly. Very good, Mona. I had planned on taking the keys from his pocket somehow, but I was lucky. He was so angry and irritated that he didn't notice them fall out of his pocket. While we were searching for the scarf, I just picked them up.
So you handed them to Maybelle.
Exactly. Very good, Miss Molly. She gave them to me when they came in.
I wondered why you were suddenly on handshaking terms.
I like Maybelle.
You used Maybelle. It's not the same thing. Still doesn't explain why I had my keys on me, why I still have my keys on me.
Well, they put them back in your pocket, of course.
But wouldn't you have noticed somebody doing that?
That was risky. When did you do it?
It had to have been during the duck and cover drill.
That was my idea. Lady Sue got the keys from me. I put them back. He didn't notice a thing.
Okay, I understand why Peggy wanted to teach John a lesson, but why would you want to help her, Maybelle?
Well, she's upset about her club being canceled.
That's right. Peggy Sue said she wanted to teach John a lesson he'd never forget. She said he'd been acting cold, even cruel lately. And the more he talked about going off to school next year, the worse it got. Like he was afraid to face the future. And he hadn't been paying any attention to me either. I tried to talk to him several times about changing the day of his car lovers club, but he just kept ignoring me. It's awful being ignored. So I agreed to help steal his car.
I could press charges.
Oh, what for? Go right ahead.
You stole my old man's car.
I thought you just said your car was parked out back.
Yeah, but, oh, great. So when the police come, you're all going to be all in on the little joke. You were right, Peggy. Someone was playing a joke. I just never thought you could do something like this. So what do I tell the police when they get here?
They're not coming. I didn't call them.
Well, I am not sure that I can say I approve of what happened here. Someone could have been seriously hurt. I mean, look at your nose, John. I understand that you felt John deserved to be taught a lesson, but thank goodness no serious harm has been done. There's just one thing I don't understand.
What's that, Miss Molly?
Well, after Matt punched John, why did you give him the scarf, Peggy?
I realized.
Surely you knew he would be suspicious.
Yes, I realized that I had gone too far. We thought he'd get a little bit nervous and we'd tell him about it, but things didn't work out like we planned. We hadn't planned on you all showing up and getting so involved. So much more came out of this than we'd intended.
I hadn't realized you all hated me so much.
Oh, John, we don't hate you, but I just realized how wrong our relationship is. I hadn't realized just how cruel you could be.
That's not me, Peggy, truly. It's true. I hated that scarf you gave me. My mother always wore the color. It makes me sick when I see it. I should have told you. I'm sorry, Peggy.
You've said some pretty hurtful things today, John, and not just to me. If it were just me, I might have carried on, not noticing until I woke up one day and realized it was too late for you to change, like your mother must have done. Woke up one day and realized who she was married to. I'm scared you're turning into your father, John. You've said some horrible things to everyone.
Peggy, I don't want to turn out like my old man. Honestly, I don't. You said earlier that I have everything. It's not true, Peggy. It's true what Mona says. I do miss my mom. And the one thing I love more than cars and you, my dad's making me give up.
Your guitar?
He says I'm wasting my time. He says he doesn't want me turning out like my mom. She's an artist, a painter.
She's subterranean.
Yeah, last time I saw her, she was wearing black like you. My dad doesn't want anything to do with her. She writes, but he won't let me write back. He controls everything I do. He won't let me listen to Elvis. He broke all my 45s. I'm sorry for insulting your father, Mac. I'm sure he was a true war hero. Mona, I'm sorry for insulting your mother and your father. I know they were good Americans. I know you are too. I'm sorry. She's a good cook too, you know, your mom.
Yeah, I know. It's okay, John.
Miss Molly, I'm sorry you lost your job. I didn't know it meant so much to you. I know you're not a communist. I should have paid more attention in class. Maybe I would have learned something.
Well, you've learned something here today, haven't you?
Yes, I certainly have, Miss Molly. Maybell, I'm sorry. I'll change the day of my car club. Oh. Oh, better yet, I'll cancel it. Peggy.
I don't know, John.
Oh. Peggy, don't be cruel to a heart that's true.
Oh,
in the kitchen. Emily Cochran was not on your program, but she also came and helped us out tonight. Thank you for coming. Robinson, if you want to take your Coke bottle home, you may.